Goedendag kijkers, welkom bij een nieuwe aflevering van ons programma In Gesprek Met. In deze aflevering praten we over een reiziger en fotograaf uit Slowakije die nu in Suriname is om een bepaald project uit te voeren. Good day, Michael. How are you?
Very good, thank you. Goedenavond, Suriname.
You're here in Suriname for how long now?
I came for 2 months. Mm-hmm.
So you'll be leaving our country at the end of September?
Yes, that's right.
Okay. You're an adventurer and a photographer. What inspired you to become an adventurer?
Well, from my childhood, I always wanted to explore and discover the undiscovered and explore some unexplored places, unknown places in the planet. So I've always been going to some adventures from my childhood, firstly also with my parents, and then when I got independent, so that's where the real adventure started, you know. Mm-hmm. And I started to look around the world, and then I realized that Latin America is the region that I really want to explore. So I ended up here.
Is this your first time in Suriname?
Yeah, it's my first time, but in this continent, it's my, I don't know, maybe like 10th time, because I traveled for 11 years here. Hmm. Yeah, during the COVID times, it was not possible, so mm-hmm. I got to know a little bit more my country, Slovakia, that I wasn't knowing before. And I finally got the opportunity to travel around my own country. Mm-hmm. Because before COVID, I knew better, for example, Nicaragua or Ecuador than my country, and it was a shame, right? So
yes,
I finally got to know also a lot of my country. Mm-hmm. And Suriname was or has been on my list for a long time, to be honest. And all, I mean, not only Suriname, but all these three Guyanas, you
yeah.
know, because these are the countries from the continent that nobody knows.
Yeah, we heard it most of the time.
Yeah, so I prefer traveling to the places or countries or regions that not every person knows, or that are basically like unknown places, you know. So that's why Guyana, Suriname, and French Guyana has been always on my list to visit. And so this year, when I was at the beginning of year trying to figure out which country is gonna be for this one, I was like, yeah, maybe finally I should go to the Guyanas finally, and I ended up here.
Did you already went to French Guyana and Guyana?
No. Suriname is my first experience of the Guyanas.
Okay, and is there a reason behind that? Why did you choose Suriname to be the first?
To be honest, Suriname out of these three Guyanas was like was the most interesting one for me. I don't know why. Maybe it's just because of a name, or because it's in the middle, or I don't know why. Or maybe because you're really like a unique country in this continent because of the Dutch language.
Yes.
Maybe like a mixture of all of these reasons, you know. So that's why I was like, let's try Suriname.
Yes.
Let's try how it's gonna turn out and how it's gonna be look like.
And how has your experience in Suriname been so far?
Well, it has been like ups and downs every single day, because it's really difficult to travel around here, to be honest. Mm-hmm. Maybe the Surinamese don't see it that way, but for the travelers, it's really like a challenging place and difficult to move around, because there is not so many roads, there is not so many public transport, not so many buses. Mm-hmm. Most of the country is a jungle, so it's really a tough place to be, and a challenge for pretty much all the travelers.
Okay, I understand. Do you already went to our interior or other districts?
Yeah. I've been, I think, to all of the districts so far, besides Sipaliwini.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this month is gonna be for Sipaliweni. So I'm planning my trips and tours there.
Mm-hmm.
So it's gonna be a real adventure now in September.
And if you had to make a choice, which of the district you found more attractive to say that?
I cannot answer this question. I don't know because all of the districts have something something different, something that is common, something that is unique.
Mm-hmm.
So I found all the districts pretty much let's say all the same. Maybe I would just divide the country between all of the districts at the north and then Sipaliweni.
Mm-hmm.
So Sipaliweni for me is like totally the other planet, totally like a real jungle.
Yeah.
And all the other districts are, let's say, kind of civilized.
Mm-hmm.
So I would just divide the country in between those two.
Okay. From what you categorize as civilized, mm-hmm. What was the most unique thing you have seen there?
Oof, there has been so many things that I got to see every single day.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. For example, my favorite animal is a sloth.
Mm-hmm.
So I got to meet a sloth in Groningen.
Yeah, Saramaca.
In Saramaca. Then I went, for example, to Albina, like the most crowded or most like you know. That kind of a place that everybody's moving around.
Yeah,
there is a lot of movement
there.
Faster. People are going to French Guiana and back. It's like a real mess, you know, at the river.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I've been to some indigenous or Maroon villages already.
Mm-hmm.
So that's totally different type of tourism. I've been to also some touristic places, for example, Frederiksdorp or
yes.
Walking around here in the center of Paramaribo, that where I finally get to see some white people, you know. So when I see white people in Suriname,
mm-hmm.
I know that I'm in a touristic place.
Yes.
So when I don't see anybody, just me, and everybody's staring at me, that's when I know that I'm the only one there, and that's not a touristic place.
Okay, I get that. Have you been to Nikeri?
Yes, already.
Okay. And what do you found, what is your meaning about our culture here in Suriname?
No, culture is so diverse and
mm-hmm.
And so unique, because you pretty much combine like the culture of maybe like five totally different like worlds, you know.
Yes.
And so there is African Maroons, there is a mixture with white, that's Creole, then you have Hindustanis, then you have Javanese, Indonesian people,
yes.
And then you have maybe some white people. So it's like when I'm walking down the streets, I feel sometimes like in Asia, then Africa, then Europe, then it's like a mixture of all three, so that's crazy.
Yeah, I think that's the beautiful
yeah.
part of Suriname.
Uh-huh.
You've mentioned that you went to some Maroon and indigenous places.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever seen that anywhere else, the way they live?
Yeah, of course, because I travel around this continent for 11 years now.
Mm-hmm.
And mostly Spanish-speaking countries, because I'm fluent in Spanish and I feel mostly at home in those countries. Here I have to speak English because
yeah.
there is no other way, because I don't speak Dutch or neither Suriname Tongo. So in those countries in this continent, I always see the let's say the similar way of living. So it's nothing new to me.
Okay, you've mentioned that you're best speaking in Spanish,
mm-hmm.
but you also speak a little bit of Dutch. So it wasn't that difficult to fit in a little bit?
No. I would put it this way, that I don't speak any Dutch. I just learned how to greet people. That means like goedemorgen or goedendag, vele dag. So I besides it, I don't know anything.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe a couple of numbers. And when I have to deal with the money and the prices, so I've seen a couple of the words, you know. Just like for a basic conversation to move around, but I don't know besides it any Dutch.
It's beautiful that you want to learn and that you already can say goedemorgen and goedemiddag.
Yeah.
On your Facebook, your socials, and I've seen that you invited locals to join you on your adventures.
Yeah.
How have people in Suriname responded to this?
Well, I've posted a couple of shots and pictures to some groups of Surinamese people. Without expecting anything, and let me tell you that some of those publications went viral.
Mm-hmm.
So and then some Surinamese friends told me that Suriname mostly relies on Facebook and not that much Instagram. So you're all on Facebook and all like checking the Facebook news.
Yes.
So when somebody from a foreign country posts something interesting. So they're like, wow, somebody's coming to Suriname wanting to explore the country. So some of those posts went viral. And even one post had 200 shares and so many likes and people commenting it. And they were sending me messages there were two groups of people, the ones that are they were just greeting me that, hey, welcome to Suriname, and we are so glad that you came here, and we're just greeting,
mm-hmm.
without wanting anything. And the other group was like trying to advise me something or propose me something or asking me if I've been to some place or they can take me, help me. So it went pretty good.
You had help in getting to some places?
Yeah, of course. Before I came to Suriname, I had 10 people.
Mm-hmm.
And now when I see my contact list of Suriname, it's getting bigger and bigger.
Yes.
Every single day. So I do have already some Surinamese friends. And it's really good when you are not
beautiful.
Alone in a totally different country, and the locals just accompany you, and they can show you around, they can help you with some things, they can help you even a bit, just translation or whatever, or just spending time, you know.
Yes, you do have a photography project here in Suriname, or you want to capture some beautiful things here in Suriname. What do you hope to capture with your photography?
Everything. Everything that I see. In every country that I go to, I take the pictures pretty much of everything that I see.
Mm-hmm.
So when I find interesting a rock on the floor, I just take a picture of it.
Mm-hmm.
When I find interesting how the people are handling, for example, fruits and the vegetables in the market, I capture it. So I don't have a preference. I want to capture all the country. But if you ask me just about one thing that I'm really interested in, it's indigenous people.
Mm, okay.
So it's the native indigenous original people living in the continent. And that's something that I look forward to in every country. So I haven't had a chance in Suriname to go to those remote places, but
yeah.
I will go definitely now in September. But I've met already so many indigenous because I went to Palmentun Indigenous Day at the beginning of August, the celebration of all the indigenous in Suriname, and it was so great to meet them there.
Okay, you've mentioned that, and then you want to capture everything you see,
mm-hmm.
but is there a specific theme or story you want to tell?
I wanna bring not only Suriname, but all the countries I go to.
Mm-hmm.
To my, Slovak audience.
Mm.
So, and not only Slovak audience, for sure, for example, Czech Republic, we are so connected, even with the language, so we understand each other. So I want to spread the knowledge of those countries, not only in my country, but also in Czech Republic. But since I can speak English, I can speak Spanish, so it's spreading the knowledge of the places and countries I visit all around the world, basically. So what I really want is to bring all the experiences and all the emotions and everything that I got to experience in the country for the audience, so
yes.
that they can see that, you know,
that's very beautiful.
through my photos and experiences.
Yes. And you have already had many adventures in Suriname. What are some of the biggest challenges you face while traveling and photographing here?
Well, definitely the public transport.
Yeah.
That's a real mess here. And there is not even a public transport to so many places that I would like to go.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something that I need to think about before going somewhere. Yeah, and it's pretty much like a daily issue for me because...
How are you going around?
I don't even live in Paramaribo. I live in Wanica district, and every single day I need to go either to Paramaribo or to some other place, and the transport here, that's pretty much no transport where I live, so I need to just be walking or hitchhiking or trying to stop somebody. You know, that's how I move around here in this country. So it's,
and how is that going?
So it's, I mean, it's going pretty good until now, but it's really like a challenging thing to do. Because in all the other countries, in Spanish-speaking countries in Latin America, there is at least some public transports going to so many places. But Suriname is like, oof, that's real jungle.
Okay.
And also besides that transport issues, I mean, the real like a challenge that I see is a disadvantage of me not speaking Dutch or San Tongo. It's like I feel really like a tourist in a foreign country and not like a local.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the language. There is still a language barrier, and even though so many Surinamese people speak English, they treat you already like a tourist. And that's not something that I'm used to, you know?
Oh.
I really want to be treated as a local,
mm-hmm.
because in the Spanish-speaking countries of this continent, they treat me like a local because of the Spanish, you know? But here, it's so difficult, and... even when I see on some people that they can speak English, they're like, oh, we don't speak, let's talk in Dutch. And I'm like, come on, guys. We need to speak in English because otherwise we don't communicate between each other. So a language barrier is one of those things that it's really tough here.
Okay. I know that my Surinamese people are very friendly, but hearing what you mentioned as a challenge, I think we have some work to do. If we look at the hospitality, you mentioned being open to staying with locals on your socials.
Yeah.
How have you experienced the hospitality of Surinamese people?
I mean, I wouldn't put it as Surinamese people. I would just put it in a way that everybody's different.
Mm-hmm.
And doesn't matter if it's Slovakia, Suriname, or whatever else. So every person is different, and every person doesn't matter the nationality, but treats you differently.
Yeah.
So there has been Surinamese treating me very good. There has been Surinamese treating me not so good. So it's like, you know. It depends on the people that you encounter,
yeah.
And that's the story.
It's true. I don't know if this if it's a good question to ask, but how have your travels, including this trip to Suriname, influenced your photography style?
My style
has been
pretty much the same since I started,
mm-hmm.
with photography. I started when I was 20. I started with Latin America. Before that, I was also taking some pictures, but it was like just, you know, a vacation with parents or going to the forest behind the house, you know, these kind of things. So I didn't even have like a professional equipment and camera and so on. But then when I was 20, I finally got my equipment. I started to make pictures. And since then, my style hasn't changed, I would say.
Yes. Have you met any Surinamese photographers?
let me think. yeah, let's say that yes.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if they are famous here, but they were taking pictures as well. So I don't know if they are famous or not. I don't know the people here, you know. But yeah, I went to some trips with local people that take pictures. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. And what advice would you give to other travelers or adventurers planning to visit Suriname?
Oof, there are so many advices that I would give them. But out of those, please learn at least some basic conversation in Dutch. That would help a lot because I have a problem with that, you know, mm-hmm. on the street. And be prepared that this is a real jungle and you're not going to a country that is really easy to travel to, mm-hmm. you know. Even though the connection to Suriname is really easy because of the former colonization of the Netherlands, I just had to go from Austria, from Vienna to Amsterdam and then change the flight to Paramaribo. Yeah. It was so easy. So you don't need to do so many stops or travel for 3 days to come here. That's so easy. But when you get here, so that's when the real tough part starts, you know?
Yeah.
So, just be ready that this is not an easy country. And I wouldn't choose it as the first destination if I didn't know any country of the Latin America before. I would just go to, for example, the countries that are really, really like easygoing for traveling. That means Peru, Colombia, some parts of Brazil, I don't know, Panama. The places and the destinations that are really like so chill. Uh-huh. And then after you get some experience, like me, after 11 years, so you go finally to the Guyanas.
Okay, I get what you're saying.
Yeah.
You have talked about a lot about our interior and the indigenous people. Have you? What is your opinion about our monumental buildings in Paramaribo City?
You mean the Dutch colonization
yes.
buildings?
Mm-hmm.
They are so nice. I really love them. I mean, I've taken so many hundreds and thousands of pictures of those buildings already, mm-hmm. and still when I go through those streets where are these buildings located, I still take more and more pictures. I don't know why, because every time I find something, some other angle or
yeah.
Position in that photography eye. And I just want to capture just the other angle, you know,
yes.
of those buildings. But they are so nice. I would have loved to stay in one of those buildings during my stay in Suriname. But unfortunately, I'm staying in Wanica.
Man, that's nice to hear. What are your plans after Suriname?
After Suriname, I finally head back home to Slovakia to rest for a couple of months. Mm-hmm. And then I need to recover in all of the aspects, like physically, mentally, financially, and everything, mm-hmm. just to keep on working, because this is what I do, is also my job, and it's not a job that that I live out of it, you know. And I'm a teacher. Yeah, I'm a Spanish teacher. That's why I know a really good Spanish. So I got my clients in Slovakia. I teach them Spanish language.
Mm-hmm.
So I would just keep on working for a couple of months, and then the next year, I will get to go to some other countries in this continent.
Will that be Guyana or French Guyana?
I don't think so, because even I'm traveling to the same region mm-hmm. every single year. I try to change the regions. So. For example, the next year should be or could be, for example, I don't know, maybe Colombia or Puerto Rico, or I don't know where I would end up, but definitely not Guyana, French Guyana. Maybe some other years to come, you know.
Okay. And what drives you to seek new adventures and stories all the time?
I don't know. That's just the way how I am. I don't know. That's because I all the time I need to just seek on adventures and photos and experiences, and not just to be sitting at my home in Slovakia and doing nothing, you know. I'm really an active person. I'm a socialized person, so I need to just go to other countries, live the other cultures. And that's where I feel really like at my environment
yes.
that I like.
Okay, and as I mentioned before, I've seen your posts on social media, Facebook, to say, how do you use your platforms like Instagram and your website to share your work and adventures with the world?
Firstly, I capture the things in the country, and then I post them on my social media.
Okay. How was the response?
Thanks to the bad algorithm on Facebook and Instagram, I don't have so much interaction that I would like to have. But yeah, there are so many people interested in my work, and they're like, whoa, you've experienced this or that, I would like to do that as well. So at least I can see that on your pictures, you know? So that's how I try to inspire the other people, motivate them to travel to those places where I travel. And As I said, I try to bring those countries to my country, and so that even my grandparents can see that, you know.
Yes. Okay. And what impressions and memories do you hope to take away from your times here in Suriname?
The best ones I can, right? when you travel to some destination, you hope for the best to live and to experience. When something bad happens, like for example, it happened also already in Suriname that I got really sick, and I was bad recovering. So that was like a bad part. This is like a bad part of traveling. But when you forget those situations and you just focus on the good that encounters you during the traveling, that's really fun. And those memories from those countries would last forever. So I would recommend everybody to travel.
Yes. And last, what message do you have for the Surinamese people?
We don't have a time that I think about it, but maybe just keep on working on what you do, and just try to make your country a little bit more developed and better, because there are so many things that I found really like ancient or old that shouldn't be like working in the 21st century. So just keep on working, try to make the things better. And when you see some white guy like me with a camera on the street, just don't get scared. Try to interact with those travelers, and you never know what kind of kindness or hospitality even that white, let's say, foreigner traveler or stranger can bring you to your heart. So be open, be more open, and just be yourself, you know.
Thank you, Michael, for your openness. Zo, kijkers, met deze woorden van Michael, hij is een wilde reiziger en een fotograaf. Hele bijzonder gesprek over zijn reis hier naar Suriname en wat hij vindt van ons land en onze mensen hier in Suriname. Bedankt voor het kijken. Gaat hij nog niet weg? Want mijn collega heeft nog een deel voor u.
Welkom bij het tweede deel van In Gesprek Met. In dit deel brengen wij een deel van de Maroon-cultuur helemaal in uw huiskamer. En dat doen wij door te praten met een van de kapiteinen van het dorp Santigrong. Ik ben Aranza Swedo en samen met cameraman Nigel Oosteling brengen wij u dit deel.
Mensen verbazen zich van Santigrong, 6 kapiteins. Hoe dan? Ja, dat is mogelijk. Een kapitein wordt in eerste instantie een leider van een groep. Een leider van een familie, van een B. Dus de kapitein wordt opgehangen aan een B. Elke B, elke familiegroep die vindt dat ze groot genoeg is om eigen boontjes te kunnen doppen, die vraagt de Gramang om een kapitein. Niet de overheid, niet de centrale overheid. Elk een volgens de Maron-traditie. Elk een die de centrale overheid vraagt om hem of haar als kapitein aan te stellen, is fout bezig. De Gramang is degene, het is zijn zaak. Het was in de koloniale periode zo en het is nu ook zo. Men probeert dat te ondermijnen, maar dat is het. Dus het gaat moeilijk met het samenwerken tussen de verschillende kapiteins hier. Maar er zijn verschillende kapiteins omdat de verschillende groepen hun autonomie willen. Ze voelen zich sterk genoeg om een eigen leider te hebben. Omdat men niet meer onder druk of onder dwang van wie dan ook willen staan. Men heeft geprobeerd eigen kapiteins te krijgen. Vandaar dat dit dorp zoveel heeft. Als het goed ging, zou het niet hoeven. Maar omdat het, kijk, als je problemen hebt en je vraagt die ene kapitein om je te helpen. En die kan niet, omdat hij gewoon niet de vaardigheden, niet de deskundigheid heeft om het te doen. Dan wil je wel iemand, want je gaat niet naar een kapitein helemaal in drie tabbetje of waar. Maar dan heb je hier je eigen leider. Het is een ingewikkelde materie, maar zo is het hier aan toegegaan. Vanaf de vredestraktaten. Die zeggen dat de mensen vrij zijn. Ze mogen zich vrij bewegen. Ze mogen economische activiteiten bedrijven. Tot heden. Een van de belangrijke ontwikkelingen die je ziet, is dat de Marons, de nakomelingen van de Marons, inderdaad geprobeerd hebben hun vrijheid vorm en inhoud te geven, in te vullen. Dus die bewegingsvrijheid die ze hebben gehad, hebben ze optimaal proberen te gebruiken door te verhuizen naar verschillende gebieden in dit land. Overal zitten ze nu in Suriname. En in ten gevolge zitten ze dan ook in het buitenland. Dus ze zijn dan niet meer geïsoleerd in hun eigen woongebied. Dat is een belangrijk gegeven. Een andere is dat door de introductie van onderwijs en christendom ze ook zijn gaan groeien op educatief gebied. Het heeft een nadeel, dat is dat de traditionele gewoontes en gebruiken bijna verdwijnen. Omdat mensen niet weten de balans te houden tussen traditie en modern. Dus of je bent traditioneel of je bent modern. Terwijl je beide kunt koesteren. Onderwijs heeft geholpen dat algemeen Marons behoorlijk vooruit zijn gekomen. Ze zijn naar school gegaan, onderwijs genoten, et cetera, et cetera. Hier ook. Vroeger was het heel moeilijk om die school te bereiken. Tegenwoordig, die school is hier in het dorp, dus kinderen kunnen daar naartoe. Een andere is de vermenging. De vermenging. Was het zo dat Marons voorheen alleen maar met hun eigen groepsgenoten, mensen die behoren tot die Marongroep, gingen trouwen? Tegenwoordig, we hebben van alles nu in het binnenland. Ik zie ze wanneer ik op bepaalde plekken kom en ik ken ze ook wel. Dus dat is ook wel iets wat je ziet voor wat betreft de ontwikkeling. Het heeft altijd een andere kant waarbij je zegt van oké. Is dat het? Moet dat op die manier? De jeugd, de jonge mensen, ook ouderen doen er aan mee. Hebben vandaag de dag bepaalde gewoontes aangenomen. En denken dat ze daarmee laten zien dat ze modern zijn. Terwijl het in feite een blijk van normvervaging is. Ik zie dingen op YouTube. Ik krijg video's toegestuurd. Dan denk ik, my god, jongen. Wat gebeurt er in onze maatschappij? Je hoeft niet dat soort dingen te doen. Hè? Niet het streven om regels te overtreden. Ik was een rebel toen ik jonger was. Ik hield niet van, en ik, t- op de dag van vandaag. Ik hou niet van in een keurslijf lopen. Dan ga je zien, ik ga protesteren. Maar vroeger zou ik het heel openlijk doen. Ik zou het je echt keihard zeggen. Tegenwoordig doe ik het wat beheerst. Kennelijk door die draden die je niet zo goed meer kan zien. Omdat ik dat ook wel weghaal. Maar ik vind dat tegenwoordig, men luistert bijna niet. Is niet goed. Je mag jezelf zijn, maar je moet wel rekening houden met de andere mensen naast je. Die Maron-diplomatie bestaat onder andere ook uit het streven om je familie vooruit te helpen. En daarmee ook het dorp, de gemeenschap waar je deel van uitmaakt. Komend vanuit een onderdrukkingspositie hebben ze geleerd om solidair met elkaar te zijn. Daardoor is hun sociaal vermogen, hun sociaal gedrag heel erg ver ontwikkeld. Je kunt niet zonder elkaar. Wel, ik ben geen diplomaat en ik heb ook niet zoveel kennis daarvan. Maar ik weet dat als je als land met een ander land wil samenwerken, ten bate van je eigen economische en sociaal culturele ontwikkeling, dat je respect moet hebben voor dat andere land. Wel, als je geen respect hebt voor elkaar als Maron-groep, Okanes vinden dat ze beter zijn, Saramakanes vinden ze juist beter zijn, die Alukus vinden van, wij zijn de dappere mensen, de Anogoto. Maar je moet dan die gemeenschappelijke deler moet je gaan zoeken. En ik vind dat Marons daar sterk in zijn. Een van de sterke dingen die ze hebben, is dat ze weten zich aan te passen, heel snel. Maar je hebt natuurlijk altijd een aantal afvallers die je ook overal hebt. Een van de nalatenschap daarvan is, ik hoor mensen toen ik nog jonger was, klagen dat Boesningere houden niet van regels. De man trobi, dat betere de man dan dat je naar Boesie de noem, kon je naar foto. Want ze kunnen zich niet aan handhaven. Is onterecht. Is onterecht. De voorouders, de ouderen van deze mensen die je nu als Marons in Suriname kan kwalificeren, één ding hebben ze hen meegegeven. Laat je niet meer onderdrukken. Dat is de boodschap die ze hebben meegekregen. Vandaar dat Marons over het algemeen, en dat is mooi, hoe een Maron zijn trots wil behouden, denkend vanuit het concept van de vrijheid die zij hebben meegekregen, en dan die Maron-diplomatie toepassen. Het werkt inderdaad door. Want wanneer je je kind opvoedt, refereer je naar wat je gehoord hebt van je ouders. En dat werkt door. Als jouw kinderen dat overnemen, zijn ze minder aardig voor jou als fotoman. Zijn ze minder aardig voor jou als wit man die hierin zit. Je hoeft maar een veel lichtere kleur te hebben dan ik. De man zegt dat je een fotoman, ze haten je niet. Maar ze wantrouwen je. Ze hebben, maar ons hebben over het algemeen een diep wantrouwen tegenover anderen die niet tot hun groep behoren. Maar daarbinnen ook is er een enorme wantrouwen. Dat is iets van die slavernij, de relatie waarin ze zijn grootgebracht. Die slaven die hier kwamen waren allemaal, bijna allemaal jonge mannen. Vitale mannen in het begin eigenlijk van hun leven. En ze hebben hun hele leven lang daarna zijn ze geconfronteerd geworden met onrecht. De voorouders hebben dat doorverteld. en het wordt verder doorverteld. Dus enorm, het heeft een enorme impact op het gedrag van de mensen. Je moet behoorlijk met hen omgaan voordat ze dat gaan loslaten. Want ik denk altijd dat je nooit in een loop mee. Nooit in een loop mee. Dus zo in de bocht naar van de man. En weet mama hoor, erg schreef. Het was een afgang voor een Maron om een relatie aan te gaan, bijvoorbeeld met een wit man.
De Maron-cultuur, een cultuur rijk aan verschillende tradities. We hebben gesproken met een van de kapiteinen van het dorp, Santi Grong. En in het eerste deel hadden wij mijn collega Richelle. Dat was het wat betreft deze aflevering van In Gesprek Met. Ik zie u graag terug bij een volgende aflevering volgende week woensdag. Ik ben Aranza, bedankt voor het kijken en een fijne dag.